then something. But I'd like to just set this meeting up that we'll do one at a time talking, so nobody talks over everything, so it'll go over the air nice and clear, and hopefully everybody understands what we're dealing with. The minutes, you said that...
Minutes are done. They're sitting in my computer, and as soon as I can get the thing to come back online so I can print, we'll have them.
We'll take action on them next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. On the Board of Appeals, I got a...
Do you have agendas?
Yeah. You have any more agendas?
Yeah, I just gave them a whole bunch of them.
Where is that? The Board of Appeals is set for August, the ZBA is set for August 15th. I have a note from the town administrator that it's going to be possibly postponed. I can't understand for what reason. It's not a vote of the selectmen, not a vote of anybody. It's a presentation by this committee. It's our part, and by Mr. Greenbaum on his part. So I actually see no reason why this thing should be postponed.
John, it's possible maybe none of the ZBA members are available that night.
Well, they set the meeting.
You should make sure, keep an eye and make sure that it's actually posted, because they've gotten into a bad habit of not posting their meetings.
Okay, that I can check tomorrow. All right. But this board, this committee, I imagine wants to go forward with it, right? We don't want no postponing, do we? Is there any reason we need a postponement? None. Okay, next thing on the agenda, the webpage. You were supposed to look into that, Mr. Fire Chief?
Yeah, I don't have anything to report yet. We're still working on it.
All right, that being said, we'll go to the police chief's presentation.
Okay. It's not so much a presentation, but I think it's probably important that I just kind of note a couple of important aspects as it relates to the police department, specifically for, and communications, specifically for the North Hadley Hall. I think we need to get some information out there that maybe some people don't know. So this committee came together and started to design the North Hadley Fire Station, and that's, in my mind, what it always was. Everyone is probably aware that our current building is in need of modifications, some expansions. We have outgrown portions of the building since its construction. Some have even commented that we outgrew it the day we moved in. I think there are probably some arguments that can be made that the fire chief and I want to be clear that we are okay with staying in that building. However, some modifications do need to be made, and when the design started being put together for the North Hadley Station, the fire chief and this committee added some portions of that building specifically for communications and for the police department. Now, I bring that up because some of the adjustments and the changes that were made for North Hadley are not necessarily going to solve some of our problems with our building now, but they will certainly help to reduce some of the strain. So I want to say thank you to the committee and the fire chief specifically for doing that. Some of our issues, and I put it in, Donald actually put together a nice book here, and I noticed that our the presentation that Mike and I made about a month ago, probably the projection plan and goals and objectives, notes some of these issues. So just for the people that are watching on TV, some of the issues that we have as far as space goes with the building that we have now is, I shouldn't say necessarily just space, but as far as communications go, we have to have redundancy. I'm sure the committee, I know the committee has talked about this in the past, I know we've talked about it at select board meetings as well, but we must have redundancy in our communications specifically. Mike has put a dedicated space within the North Hadley design for communications that will be state of the art, and we will be able to move there in the event that our building goes down. What was it, 2 weeks ago? We lost power. The generator failed to kick in, so our building was dead, just like everybody else on the street. While we tried to figure out what the issues were and tried to get communication restored, the power luckily came back on. We do have our emergency management trailer that the fire chief has put together for us, but that is for exactly what it's named for, emergencies. In the event that the building goes down or we have some type of catastrophe, we need a place to put people, to staff, to a building to staff so that we can work out of until we can get things, you know, back together. North Hadley Station will have that. It may sound like the next item may sound like a small item, but storage. Storage is huge for us. We are required by law to store certain documents, certain records for specific periods of time, specific places, meaning locked, climate controlled, and there's also different levels of security that we have to adhere to when it comes to evidentiary items or simply records. North Hadley Fire Station, Police Station, whatever you want to call it, Public Safety, will have that for us as well. There is a potential in looking at the floor plan, the mezzanine level, there's a potential that we could make some modifications up there to actually have evidence storage, or at least help out with some of our space issues as it relates to evidence on that mezzanine level. We would have to investigate that a little bit further. Another issue, locker space, locker rooms, places for officers. We haven't had the available funding and capital to begin this project. We've requested over the last couple of years, and there just is not enough slices in the pie, which is completely understandable. We are over capacity in our male locker room, and we are at capacity in our female locker room. When I say over capacity, I mean that there are several officers who do not have a place to change, do not have a place to lock up their firearms, and there are officers in there who are sharing lockers. While the North Hadley Station will not solve this problem completely, once again, it may give us the ability to reduce some of that strain. The fire chief has designed a portion of this floor layout with spaces for lockers, a small locker room, changing area, with showers and things like that. Those are things that could certainly help reduce some of the strain. And the reason I bring that up is because we haven't, obviously this is still in its, you know, young stages, but I've been speaking with the supervisors as it relates to stationing an officer up there. We, right now, when we put our officers on the street, we cover districts. This helps us to, you know, so that officers know exactly which area of town they're responsible for. And we have north, south, and central, basically. While I can't say with certainty right now that we would be able to put an officer up there or that we would have the officer who's responsible for the north portion of town be up there all the time, it would be a tremendous, I think it would be something that the people in the north end of town would probably appreciate, the fact that they might be able to go to that North Hadley station and speak face-to-face with an officer without having to drive to the center station. I think Mike brought it up last time. It may be kind of a corny idea, but, you know, I thought something along the lines of a blue light out front that the officer could flip on when he or she is there in the station and give, you know, folks an opportunity to actually come and speak with someone face-to-face rather than calling on the phone or something like that. It's just kind of a cool thing to be able to offer the folks up north, and it gives the officers an extra workstation, an extra place to work, place to change, and a little bit more space. So those are just a few of the issues that came to mind when we started talking about this, and Mike has, and this committee has really kind of turned this from just a fire station to more of a public safety, all-inclusive station, which will be able to house firefighters, police officers, and communications. So all three of our integral parts of public safety will be able to be in this building. So.
Does anyone have, thank you, Mike. Is there anyone that has any questions on this or any comments?
Since we're looking at a facility in North Hadley, is there any merit to moving the main operation of the fire department to North Hadley and use the East Street Center as a substation to facilitate the police department's need for space?
Mike, you want to answer that? He's talking about the fire department.
I mean, my first initial response is that we have very little traffic in the center of town, so I mean, it's something we could look at, but it was designed as our central station. We have a higher call volume, Route 9, the Russell Street area, but I mean, it's something we could evaluate.
I'm just asking because if we're gonna try and accommodate both your department and police department, and maybe we redefine who's where and what building does what, so we can address two items at the same time. You may be 100% correct. I don't know the call volume. I don't know what the demand is on the department. Maybe you're 110% correct that it needs to stay on East Street. But I'm just, after the police chief has offered the crunch for space, just wondering if there's any merit to redefining who's where.
I mean, I can tell you in my opinion, I like the idea of having a public safety complex. I like the idea of both agencies being in the same building, which is why in my mind I've always looked at this as the substation. This would be the substation for both, for the fire department, and then, well, like I said, when the police were added, it just gives us a little bit more of an opportunity to ease the burden in some of the areas. I don't know that this building is going to be a solution to those problems. As a matter of fact, I can tell you right now it won't be. There will still need to be modifications made to Center Station as well, in my opinion. But we've actually discussed that very, at least I've heard it discussed, that very idea of sort of reallocating or moving the fire department and reallocating that space and having the police kind of take over a certain portion of the building. But the discussion that I've always heard was not moving them to another location. It was simply, you know, building offices and things like that on the opposite side of the building, the center station. So I think the thought has merit. But I just don't know that this is going to give us the space capabilities that we would need to split the departments up like that.
My thought on that was just North Hadley could be no greater than a substation, given the location of this. Always was. And now we're enhancing it by making facilities for the police to get in a backup for communications case. One site gets hit by a tornado, lightning. You got a backup, and there's not, this thing is not big enough really to bring all the equipment, but you got to look at the location. This one is centrally located for fire and for police. So having the substation, it just enhances it bigger and gives it more territory and quicker coverage. So, you know, that's the way I particularly look at it. Would you like to make further comment, Chief?
Looks like Selectman Paczynski put the five-year phase plan in here, so you can get some ideas of a snapshot of the community that I put together. And then also, the call volume since 2005 with some graphs on what we're looking for calls. It doesn't break it down by location. You're sitting next to one of the gentlemen who put the station where it's at today and researched that as well. So you might want to comment on that. I know that, like I said, our heaviest fire load is definitely the Route 9 area, without a doubt, and the Route 9 corridor. The hazards, the risk analysis that we do on specific buildings, and the greatest demand for, you know, time frame of getting to a call if something happens, and that location basically cuts the town in half, and that's how we space out our firefighters as well. So we have a dividing line between North Hadley and then Central and South Hadley, the south end of Hadley. So I think, like Mike said, I think the discussion was trying to establish space and additional space at the center station, because this is going to be a North Hadley substation. And like we've discussed before, this we talked about building it out to the max, so we're not coming back in a pinch again 20, 50 years down the road saying, oh, we don't have enough room again. So we were looking at this as having the ability to expand, but then also having the ability to house police and fire in the event something happens, but then also being able to possibly put a North Hadley, you know, a small substation for the police where they'd have the ability to operate out of that area.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a comment? Simply, North Hadley, when you look at the town lines, Sunderland is about 3 miles to the north. When you go to the South Hadley line, you're encompassing about 10 miles from North Hadley, which is a long distance. And if that's going to be your main station, I think we would be doing a disservice to the Hockanum area.
Myron, would you like to weigh in on this?
When we located the center station, at first we were going to be on River Drive where the school is, and looking at the traffic patterns and also the piece of property, it was determined that would, for the benefit of the school, they would end up with a larger piece of property that would allow the fire department to be on East Street. They wouldn't have to go on Route 9 unless they have to go across Route 9 or down Route 9. They could respond all the way north. They could respond out to East on Rocky Hill Road to get out to that section of town. That location turned out to be very good considering some of the other places where they thought they wanted to be on Russell Street, or even be across on the other side of somewhere, the other end of East Street. But the most central location for the whole town, either respond south or north, especially running an ambulance, was that little section of area there. Really, the corner of East Street and Rocky Hill Road is about as central as you can get. So that's why the station ended up being on East Street. As far as North Hadley is concerned, putting the police functions up there enhances the police operation, but primarily it's going to be for the benefit of the firefighters, and I think we're probably running about one-third of the fire crew being in the northern part of town. These guys are willing to come out and train and go to incidents. I think benefits the fire department if we can put apparatus close to where most of these people live in another section of town, where they can take part in fire department operations and operate efficiently as an engine company not having to run all the way to the center of town and probably most of the time being too late, you missed the truck. Incident's already taken care of. Pretty soon you're going to have people that are going to sort of lose interest and not really taking part in anything. And it's going to be a case of, gee, we're willing to go to the fire. Do you think the town would at least provide us with apparatus close by so we can respond to northern incidents in north, or it can respond efficiently and effectively to incidents in the center of town? If we don't have a station in North Hadley, and we do have people up there, we will decrease the, or increase the response time to just about every incident north of Russell Street. It's not just a case of we're going to increase the response time north. It's going to be everything that they would effectively respond to, leaving from North Hadley with a fire apparatus versus driving to the center of town to go get a fire apparatus and go back, or to get a fire apparatus and head out toward the mall area. North Hadley or apparatus would respond to the mall area a lot of times down Stockbridge Street is the fastest way to get there. In other words, they would go cutting diagonally to get to an incident versus driving south and then driving east to get to an incident. Even if we end up with two people on duty down here, primarily ambulance crew, they're going to be waiting for that backup. A two-man fire department doesn't do very much except assess what's going on, make some preparatory hose lays. But it's primarily going to be the backup crews, be it from the center, or if you have men up north who can respond right away with a piece of apparatus instead of driving to the center to man a piece of equipment, can make a big difference. So that's pretty much the story, the way I see it all.
How many volunteers do we have in North Hadley? What would that be, the north of Huntington Road?
Huntington Road is considered the cutoff point between north and south. And I'd say right now we probably have maybe eight to ten,
mm-hmm.
So just under half of the call force.
I know myself and Donald, we toured six departments within Western Mass and out of Western Mass, and every full-time department still depends on the call firemen. In fact, we were in Sardinfield, there was one full-timer, and within minutes, the highways there, there was like eight people that responded. We couldn't believe how fast it was, and off they were. There was a serious accident, and the fire, ambulance, everything was dispatched, and they were gone. You know, it was amazing how fast it was. Like, it was, they were like all full-time people, but it wasn't. It was one full-time officer, but they got so many call firemen, you know, and they're lucky that way. Is there any question? Howard, do you have any comment on this at all?
No.
Donald, would you like to? I think now, having said all that, we ought to get into your site plan of your layout of your thing there. Has anything been added, changed, or altered?
No. No, it's still the same as the last meeting. You had requested that, and I can try and get this done to get it drawn up,
mm-hmm.
You know, not by pencil,
yeah.
And eraser, so we could certainly try and get it into an actual scale drawing.
Is there plans for
this up over there?
Is there plans for everyone?
Can you put this up on
yeah.
the box?
Is there plans for everyone to see?
No, this is it. We have to get plans made. I don't have the ability to.
Okay.
I mean, I can go to.
You
want to
take a look at that, Howard, and just pass it down to everybody? You've seen it, right, Mike?
Yeah.
You
yep.
worked on that.
Yep.
So, would you like to make some further comment on that, on the interior?
I think we covered pretty much everything at the last meeting when we were live with everybody. I think we've gotten some feedback on it that it makes. It seems to have made sense to some folks. Of what we're discussing. I think you folks have brought back some information looking at the pictures,
mm-hmm.
And the comments that you got from the fire chiefs or firefighters for some, what we, you know, what we should be careful with and what we should consider before going forward with building this up.
I'll tell you.
Positives and negatives.
I get an awful lot out of that tour, talking to chiefs throughout the Western Mass about positive things, negative things, and what they would have done different, or what they would look to do to change things. So we don't end up, you know, try to get the most out of, bang out of our buck on this. I would like to have, Donald, you got all these things pinned out with information we got on the sites we got. Would you like to read those off for the,
The different sites we went to?
Yeah, well, there's still information that we have to get, but we can call back and, you know.
Do you want me to comment on them to a little bit?
Well,
or
just
no?
What information, like the population of the place, the budget if we got, what kind of volunteers they have full-time.
Okay. The first one was Belchertown, and it's solely fire. But they do have like 8 full-time officers, which constitutes their ambulance. Now, they incorporated it into their fire department. When they built it, it's Belchertown has a population almost 14,300, which is quite large. They have 24 call firefighters. The police does their dispatching on 202. And even though their station is less than 20 years old, they're finding the way they built it, they're in dire need of space everywhere. Their apparatus area is about 7,000 square feet. And in our books for the committee members, there's a couple of handout sheets from the chief, which really are beneficial. We went next to Granby.
Before you went to that, you mentioned about the ambulance. They do hire paramedics there, right? There were paramedics that were / firemen.
Correct.
And also with the police department dispatching, they had a hit with lightning at the police department, and the fire department can take over. It would be like our substation. And vice versa, the thing, lightning hit the fire station, and they can switch off like that. That's how they're set up there. And then they're set up in their fire apparatus for dispatch, you know, firemen to deal with the scene and all that. So go ahead, next, Donald.
Okay, the next one we went to, Granby. Again, it's a police and fire complex. It was built in 2011. They have a population about 6,300, 22 call force firemen, and 2 full-time officers, a chief and a lieutenant. They also run an ambulance on their own, and it's done with 8 paramedics that are also firemen. They do their own dispatching. They don't use it as a CD shelter, no grant money. About 8,000 square feet of Bay Area space. They're, you know, it's fairly new, and they're quite satisfied with the building and design. They are now on that one. The next one is really interesting. We went to Great Barrington, and believe it or not, their population is about 10,900, but during the summer and skiing season, it escalates to almost 20,000. Their fire station is 14,600. It was built in 2009. 20 call firemen, and they only have 1 full-time officer, the chief. And the way Great Barrington operates, I was really surprised. They have a lot more regulations. They're the only one in the state that is a volunteer organization, and they have a hospital in their district. So that means they have to adhere to a great deal more regulations. The police dispatches for them. They have plenty of storage. They told us a lot of things there that were really good, simple and durable, and less technology. Money is very tight for this department. It's funny, the chief says, everybody else in Great Barrington gets paid. The library, rec department, and in Great Barrington, they expect the fire department to operate on volunteers. All of their custodial help are elderly individuals that come into town to clean it. And his call force is dwindling, and they're not coming back to fill it, and he's in a quandary. He says in a couple more years, he has no idea what they're gonna do there unless they come up with some money and allow them to have a full-time department. And when we went out to most of these places, some places have good call forces, but the general knowledge that we accepted, everyone is having a tough time on their call forces today.
Before you go to the next one, Donald, sure. I'd like to weigh in on some of that. What really hit me is what he said out there. He said the police, they have their full time. The highway, they have their full time. The park and recs have their full time. All of them have full time, but here he's stuck running ambulance, rescue, and fire service as a one full-time officer. He says, I don't know some days how I even can make it through the day. It's getting to be very stressful. And I see this in all the travels, the story's the same. The story started that volunteers put fire departments together throughout the state. Police didn't have that. They had either their part-time officers working on duty, but firemen, it was always on call. And it was like expected within all those communities that this is gonna happen forever. But forever is coming to a close. So I think we really need to let the folks out there know just there's not another town that's gonna come in and take care of Hadley. And Hadley is not gonna, they're up to their eyeballs taking care of their own town. We have a mutual aid in case of a major emergency, but that chief was just, I really felt he was a young chief. I really felt sorry for the guy because everything is on his shoulders. And he reminded me of you, Chief, really. It's not getting less work, it's getting more work. Okay, Donald, go to the next one.
Okay, the next one, it was Montague, which is a District 2 fire department. They also have a main station in Turner's Falls near the schools. They service a population in Montague. It's broken into villages, about 2,000 people. It was built in 2003. They have no full-time help, and they have about 30 call firemen, which is a tremendous number. And they operate a ambulance service, no paramedics, EMTs. They also have Turner's, the main station, do their dispatching, no CD shelter. Even though it was built in 2003, they're in need of additional space all over in the building, he said. And one thing, where they built, a family had a large farm and they donated all the land to the fire district because the father at one time was part of the fire district and the family wanted to do that. So that was interesting on that one. We went to South Deerfield District 2 today. I think everybody knows it's just up the street from Yankee Candle. Everywhere we went out of this, it seemed like this one would best suit our needs. It was built in 1993, and their area that they serve is about a little over 7,000, 20 full-time firemen, and only, 20 call members and one full-time officer there. He's not the chief, but he's the assistant chief. They share their ambulance with Whately Deerfield in Sunderland. A surprise thing, most of the people in that area, all the towns, get their dispatching done by Shelburne Falls State Police, which was a surprise to me. Theirs was built in 1993, as I said, and just 6 months ago, They put a seam metal roof on to the tone of about $300,000 also. It's a fairly large garage. Their bay is 81. He really emphasized getting volunteers is getting tougher. No community room there. And one thing he really spoke about is VAM boxes for air and heat, which can regulate the building much better and every room. And we didn't have any idea what the cost factor was for that, but he said that would be something to investigate.
That's actually what we're doing in the center station right now.
Right now.
That was the funding that we received for that. Yes. So VAV boxes.
The next one is Sunderland Police and Fire Complex. They serve a population of about 3,600. It was built in 203, 12,900 square feet. They have no full-time officers. They have a call force of about 15, and they've got about five that are in training, I guess. They also share the ambulance with Waitley Sunderland Deerfield. Very little storage in that when they built it. In fact, behind the building where they built it next to the highway garage, they can't go out into the back and expand anywhere because it's basically wetlands, he said. So they have a call volume about 120 per year and growing. And one thing the chief up there emphasized is taking a hard look at your bids, and even though you have sometimes a low bidder, it may not be in your best interest to do that, you know. And he said you really have to investigate that area.
Comment on that, Donald. He did, when he talked about the low bidder, he said there was a lot of problems with that there, and they're still paying for that today.
Sturbridge was a fire and police complex. It was built in 1989, 10,000 population, full-time eight. They want another. Police have 20 full-time. That's full-time eight, wanting nine for the fire department. They also do their own ambulance. They have eight paramedics. They dispatch their own. One thing is the town hall in Sturbridge is very small, and they converted an old building like ours, tried to modernize it a little bit, but all the records are being stored at the fire station and police station, and they have absolutely no room there. The other thing, when they built it, the front door is level, but the back bays are down in a gully. And they have a very difficult time getting their cruisers and fire trucks up onto the main road in the wintertime. And they're also located in a very bad intersection, which I'm surprised they didn't have any type of locking lights there to stop it, but they did it, you know.
Further comment on that station, police and fire, to me, I walked through a submarine, and that's what I had a feeling, that the way they designed that building, the halls were so narrow, there was cubby holes all over the place. It was just go around corners, come out this door, sally port, instead of walking into a room there where you do the booking and everything, you got to walk right around the building. You know, the front of the building looks like a house. You know, I mean, really colonial looking.
Oh,
it's on it's on Route 20, a real busy highway.
It's got dormers on the front.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, they got, I think it's three stories there: the cellar, the main floor, and then upstairs.
Do you want to pass this around, Mr. Chairman, just to show them
the
choice of? We went to like six or seven, and this one certainly outshines any of them we looked at. For our needs.
Our opinion that that's nice. Saudi fuel, that is the south elevation, would really, we feel, would be the nicest one for Hadley. There's still other information that we're going to follow up and call back with these, you know, like budgets they have. We want to get all that, and so I think all that stuff is important information. The stairway, you had a stairway in yours, right? And which one had that stairway that the last mezzanine? One we were up?
To the mezzanine?
Yeah.
Yeah, Granby. Granby had one.
Yeah.
Belchertown had
Dave
one.
Barrington, yeah.
They had their training room or exercise
training
room.
Exercise.
Right. Really nice setup. You could see the whole apparatus, all the engines and trucks down there. So that was nice. Did you see that layout there, Frank? You got any comment on that?
The building that you have right
now? No, the comment.
No, it hasn't come this way.
Right, we haven't got it yet.
Donald, right here.
Which one?
Yeah. Oh.
What we got to do is, I guess that, was that OMI? That's not, the selectmen didn't finish that process?
The OPM?
OPM, to price this out. So I've been running around getting prices on different things. Myron, you had a price there. You figured out, what was that for?
Phil.
For the Phil?
Figured on.
Did you figure that out, like prevailing wage?
3 feet of fill on the site, did a 150 by 150 foot area. I don't know exactly what the layout of the new building is going to be for the rear parking lot, but the rear parking lot probably get a slope so we can catch the water and put it in that detention basin.
There's not going to be detention.
Probably around $75,000 for that. To move in the hydrant, you probably end up with a new hydrant. Look at about $5,000 for that.
Did you figure that out as to go out to bid for prevailing wage?
Yeah.
You did? Yeah, I stopped over Warner's today, and he had a breakdown of $34,000, and I said this thing won't be built till probably the spring. So he said budget $40,000. That's for the entire parking lot. Right around the whole building to blacktop that. And what else did we have there?
I have a couple of numbers I could share with you, John. You can just use them as a benchmark. And a lot of the numbers, what influences these numbers is the equipment that goes into the building. Hazmat equipment is very expensive, has a big impact. Okay, and these are prevailing wage bids that we provided. One is to the town of West Springfield, which was 2014. It was $467 a square foot. That includes site. Westboro was 2013. You need a pen?
Okay. This steps out, don't worry.
Here.
What heck's my other one? The first number was 400.
West Springfield was bid in 2014, $467 a square foot.
Yeah.
Westboro was 2013 at $307 a square foot. And Ware, which was 2011, was $351 a square foot. That's building, site, paving, and the fit out. It doesn't include the soft costs, which are your design costs.
So what would you say that we would use?
If you just throwing numbers around, I took these three numbers, added them together, and divided by three, which brings it to about $375 a square foot. And based on the building size that we had been talking about, 65 by 100, you're about $2.4 million. And then you'd have probably architectural fees about 10% on top of that.
$2.4
million.
Plus 10%.
Plus 10.
And you know, you can lighten the numbers up by changing the structure, but these are just to give you a benchmark.
These are not, this is, these buildings are not pre-engineered buildings.
They are not pre-engineered. Right. But the last one, the Westboro, was a wooden structure, which 307.
Mm-hmm.
Wood frame.
Pre-engineered a lot cheaper,
well,
right?
You know, you, based on your sketch here, you put a mezzanine into this, and you're doing a pretty good build out. You're probably about 307 once you get said and done.
Mm-hmm.
But those are just, you know, because this is, we're talking in concepts now.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to give you some numbers that you can chew on.
Could you explain the hazmat part? What did they consider hazmat?
The equipment relative to handling the hazmat is storage of product. These projects that I've rattled off, you know, the contractors had to buy the product. So when the fire department walked in the door, it was all set and ready to go.
Gotcha.
With the exception of a fireman's apparel.
Mm-hmm.
So any sort of hazmat equipment. Was
so the washers and dryers and.
Right, exactly.
Okay. Interesting.
Chairman, did I make a comment?
Yeah.
You know, one thing in our travels, Frank, one of the first things you said at our meeting, and I'm 100% in agreement with you now, total build out of that lot, not coming back there and piecemealing at a later date, because you save money, and we're looking at a structure possibly 60 to 80 years life on it. I guess the way, if you go with block and brick and, you know, and probably be different with the other. I don't know, how do you feel, like pre-engineered building versus block and brick?
Well, you know, you talk about a pre-engineered building, and so what you've got is a pre-engineered steel frame, but then you have to talk about how you're gonna dress it up for the community. Is it gonna be a masonry facade? Is it gonna be clapboard? Or are you gonna put metal siding on it? You know, pre-engineered is primarily the skeleton.
Right.
And then you have to talk about what the committee needs or the community needs to talk about, what do they want it to look like. You know, if
we've seen one with a stone front, metal back, and
right,
metal sides, and a standing seam roof. Pre-engineered, clear span. I certainly, when you walk into the apparatus room and you don't have no columns there, you know, it's so much nicer to set up, say, the winter, you get you want other equipment to stay in there and double it up, say, take it out of your main station to put it there. You can do that. With the columns in there, you're just restricted to your rolls that you have, your two bays.
Well, you're going to have columns on your outside walls where the overhead garage doors are. You know, maybe in between the garage door, you got a column.
Right.
The pitch of that roof is going to run the short distance, which is the 65 feet from street
to the back.
Warner's Pond. So the trusses are running whatever direction that is, east, west, or north, south, but they're running perpendicular to River Drive.
Right. They're going to be facing to the west, right?
They would be right.
The doors.
West. The doors would be facing west, yes.
Doors right. Would be facing west.
And that'll be the eve end.
Steel is going to run east-west in that structure.
Right, right. They'll exit on the eve end of the building, not the gable, right?
Correct.
Well, the gable will be all the way, you know, down the sides.
Right.
But that won't impact anything.
Right.
Either way, it shouldn't impact your apparatus base.
Mm-hmm.
I guess one thing we have to remember, we're building this in a historical district. To the left is the church, very old, and to the right will be the hall, which will be renovated. We're investigating to see, the chairman of the CPA committee is calling Boston to find out if we can get some money from the CPA for the historical aspects of this building, and we'll be getting that information back in the near future.
Right. Is there anything that you have done with cost on the inside of equipment, and have you priced out anything?
No, that's actually going to be one of my questions was, is, you know, the square foot price as far as, you know, prevailing wage goes and all that, that doesn't take into consideration any of the technology that has to go into these buildings,
right? No, it doesn't. Those numbers that I've given you do not include computers or communication hardware, desk or chairs, that's not in there. It'd be the robust equipment that a department might need, but not the...
This would be the structure and the walls, that's it?
Structure, walls, and any, say, special equipment that might be hazmat.
Would that...
The higher numbers, the numbers get big when you start adding hazmat equipment.
Does that include sprinkler? Would that be sprinkled as well?
Sprinkled buildings.
Because I hear that's a very large cost.
Right.
Sprinklers. Reading up on some of these newer buildings, the very big cost is those sprinklers.
One thing that we should keep in the back of our mind is that I presume this is going to be either be heated with oil or propane.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so we'd have to look into the ramifications of the Lake Warner being in close proximity there, how we're going to deal with fuel storage.
Well, most of the stations that we went, they had two those 330 tanks inside for oil.
Where were those, inside?
Right inside the building, right where the boilers were. We got...
In other words, above ground storage.
Mm-hmm. Right. Nothing below. You couldn't even do that.
As far as the technology... I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
As far as the technology goes, John, we can... Mike did all the pricing and all the specs on our communication center now. It would be literally a portion of what that is. It's just as far as workstations go. We can certainly provide the committee with some prices of what that stuff costs.
I actually brought those numbers. So we're looking at approximately for a single setup. And this, again, is a 2004 quote, so you can probably add percentage to this, but for a single setup, it was $53,963.
What is that?
That's a dispatch console, and you can add probably about $7,000 for the equipment that you need to put it into. So the furniture, it's called the furniture.
So would you say like $75,000 for communication?
I would say... Yeah, I mean, for a high estimate, yeah. For by the time it would get
would
built
out. A radio tower?
The radio tower is not included. That's one thing I haven't researched yet, because we have a receiver at that new, the new station, the Montgomery Rose site. So I think we might be okay without having a receiver. We would just have to put a repeater in or something. I think it would limit the amount of equipment that we would need for that. But that's something we'd have to look into.
Now, Willie didn't come here tonight. He was supposed to have prices on an auxiliary generator.
He was looking into the generator, and that's... We're also reaching out to FM, who services our generator, to get the names of what they would recommend, something that's going to last and not... Having the issue that we had at the station last week, I had a chance to speak with the generator company that came out to fix it, and some of these newer generators with all the electronics and everything, some of them are coming out really, really rough, and they're having a hard time keeping up with parts because they're breaking down so much. So he's willing to give us a name of some more sturdier, better, having a better reputation for service.
And it wasn't talked about on that MS4 that's going into effect that the town's mandated. Wherever you put the station, you got to comply with MS4. And Tom Kucher from Time Bond took a ride out there and checked this out. He says to comply with that, now this is all underwater storage there, because you can't drain no water off-site in the pond anyway. That is a tag of $125,000 today. So, you know, it just keeps getting bigger and bigger.
You know, an interesting factor that I learned, 5 of the 7 sites we went to they're the problematic ones. And all five of those sites were cut by town meeting from their original cost significantly. And today they're all suffering because of that, just like we are with our central station now, because we took a significant cut at town meeting and continued to build, and we're paying it for day, and it's only 20 years old, which is a shame.
How, just, I guess for myself and the taxpayers, we started out with a substation concept, and I guess how far-reaching are we proposing to go? I know we want to be able to, if Central Station is down, have a location to go to, but I don't, you know, I'm wondering how much expansion is required up there.
It's still going to be a substation and a backup for the main station.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think what he's asking is does it, are we going too far with it?
Yeah, we're overreaching. Thank you. Are we overreaching?
Is there a way? You know, I know we talk. I think the problem is that when the subject originally came up, the thought was to build as big as you can build on that parcel. And I think maybe that's what he's getting at, is maybe that was, you know, now we're up over $2 million just for the prevailing wage square footage estimate. Maybe there's a way to scale back. I guess is that what you're getting at?
I'm asking the committee where they want to go with this. I'm not saying no, but it just seems to be growing.
Well, it's what's really killing this is the prevailing wage, and it's the mandate. Even like the wherever you put the station, you got to comply with MS4 drainage.
Right.
There's no way around that.
That's correct.
Right.
But you know,
maybe we could do this in a phases.
Well, I'm not a big fan of phases.
Nice. Well,
because you may say today I'm saving $5, but when you go to put that next
add
piece
10.
On. You're paying 10 to 15
for it. Right, exactly.
So I'm of the mindset, if you're going to do it, go up and do it once and be done with it. But when I look at this drawing, and I thank the parties that spent a lot of time drawing this out, my initial thought was this is a substation to house the trucks with a couple of offices in the case of an emergency. And that's where we were going, and now we're looking at this sketch, and I don't take this the wrong way, but we've got several offices, we've got showers, we've got a kitchen, we've got sally ports. You know, it just seems that we're generating a station, full-blown station, maybe a little smaller in footprint than Central Station, but we're building a station.
Well, we were asked, I mean, when we initially discussed this, and it was the reason why when Mike and I sat down, we were told that we didn't want to have to come back again when we're out of room.
I'm trying to ask the committee where we should be going with this.
So we were being, you know, when we designed that, it was a single, originally there was more, and we cut back because originally there was multiple showers for men's and women's, and then we said, let's just put one. So one shower, which... You know, if you look at any fire department in North Hadley, it was actually put into the capital plan for that station to get a shower stall put in there, because your guys coming back from these fires nowadays have nasty stuff on them and they're taking it home. And you're seeing, if you look at all the literature of the number of firefighters that are coming down with cancer, that's why that shower was added in there. Mm-hmm. And then we were, you know, we're tasked to build out for expansion. And like I had told you, the original plan wasn't scaled out that big.
I'm just
explaining.
I don't want you to take it that I'm
not at all. Not at all. Not at all. No defense at all. I'm just trying to explain why we had set it up that way.
See, I look at this, and we have up there, what do we have? Two garage bays up in the presently
Correct.
Up in North Hampton
and a bathroom.
well, your sketch here, we have two garage bays, and the other half of the building is administrative and rooms. Somehow, when I thought we were building something in a couple of offices, I was thinking maybe a quarter of the building tops would be offices and support in the event of an outage downtown. We've turned this into more two garage bays and offices.
That the scale of that is for that outlay of that truck there.
Yeah.
That's our ladder truck, so our longest piece. So we scaled it out.
But ultimately, it's two garage bays.
Correct. Yeah. I just wanted to give you a scope. So that's our biggest piece of equipment that we have, and the dispatch center was built out to be able to handle what they need for space. That was measured off of multiple plans. And then a simple, the office, and then what we, I mean, basically it was set up as potential storage, or then also if down the road, again, we're looking at not having enough space, you have the ability to expand up into the mezzanine area or into those storage rooms that could be converted into living quarters if needed. It was kind of just a long-term projection of potential. It can be scaled up, can be scaled back.
See, my feeling is to look into this is to offer the entire town the most services we can actually give everybody, and to produce that so it covers the entire town evenly. And it's, you're not going to do this outside in the pup tent. You know, you can't store this equipment. You, if you take the communication backup system out, I mean, that's really a lot of money right there. You know, I mean, you can start pulling stuff out of there, and I mean, you know, you leave it for two bays for two trucks and leave the stuff there, but there you go again. We're gonna come back later and do this later and spend more money later. You know,
I'm asking the question,
right?
Because ultimately we're going to be asked the very same
right.
question by the taxpayers.
Exactly. Right.
And the question even gets bigger than that, Frank, because we're talking other buildings, we're talking updating the town's infrastructure, you know, and our financial picture leaving last town meeting didn't look very good, but it's come back a long way. And we're taking a lot of debt off because of the school and the fire complex. So we envision in the next 3 years, we could spend in this town $4.5 million and not raise taxes.
As an ex-finance committee member, I would suggest you revisit that.
They are, everybody's looking at it now, but you know, over the period of time.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's what this.
How can I help now that I put a damper on this?
No, you didn't. You know, that's
not
put
that
it on the table.
That was my intent. I just wanted to.
Absolutely, put it on the table. That's fine. Howard.
Yes.
I see smoke coming over out of that corner. What do you have to say?
No, I agree with everything that Frank has said. You know, you do have to get to a point. It's one thing to look at a wish list and say, this is what we need, this is the future, this is what we want. It's something else to sit back and say, well, what can we afford, and find something that serves both desires. Again, I think you should build it to the capacity, going back in and trying to phase things, or, you know, jury rig stuff always costs you more in the long run. So I think to build the biggest building you can on the site that serves your purposes is the way to go. Maybe there's a way to phase the interior so that you're not spending, you know, if communications, for example, turns out to be much more than we thought. You know, maybe there's a way to, you know, to phase that in.
Mm-hmm.
they're expensive buildings. There's no way around it.
Well, it's always what you put into it and the equipment that makes it work. That's a costly thing. But you know, again, you know, I don't know. I thought that this thing was going to be a pre-engineered building that would drop the cost on architectural fees and the cost of that building. You know, I would say, you know, I would definitely support like a brick veneer front or block front. The standard seam building, what is that, a 50-year roof is the one you're putting on the station now?
I don't know what their warranty is on the, usually the metal is pretty long, right. Long term.
You know, the other thing to bear in mind too, this project would be well over $3 million if we had to go out and buy a site somewhere for $500,000-$600,000, added to the 2.4, so we're over 3. So there's a savings there, you know, which possibly, I would say, that saving should go into the building for future life, you know, 60, 80 years, if it's possible. But everybody would like to get money back or reduce their taxes, but it's an enviable time for a municipality. We went out and borrowed a month ago, $347,000. We got it for less than 0.75%. You know, and for a town now to invest in their future, it's just a good time to do it for our community now.
Any other comments or suggestions? Myron, what do you think about it? Do you think it should be built as a phased project or?
The only thing you could look at in phases would be how you equip the inside of it.
Right.
Looking at what it's going to cost to set up a dispatch.
Type of building, too.
The only problem is it's going to end up being like some of the stuff we left out of the main station. We just never got added. The primal vent system. We couldn't afford it then. Something we could do in the future. Well, it's been there a long time and it never came along. And now it's probably going to cost 3-4 times what it would have cost to build a station. There's very few stations in the state that have people inside of it and don't have a climate system going.
What is that? Would you explain what that system is?
You're picking up all the exhaust gases and you're keeping them from coming in the atmosphere in the station. There's the people in that station there, and every time somebody even sprays a can of paint on the apparatus floor, you get a message from the dispatch. We know darn well every time the apparatus starts up, you get the same situation. Everybody's just living with it. But we were going to put a primal vent system in the future, but like I say, the future never comes.
Yeah, one station we visited, remember, Donald, the guy got actually sick there, and they had to put those systems on the truck, on every truck, because he got sick from that diesel exhaust. He got sick on. So I mean, it's
you know, the other thing I noticed in my travels, South Deerfield was built in 1989, which constitutes, it's going to be 27 years old, and this is the first major repair they had, is replacing their shingle roof. Nothing else in that building has ever been replaced, he said. Yeah. Little upgrades for things with the fire department and, you know, minor things. But I think as a committee, we have to take, like John and I have doing, as a committee, we should take a ride up there and look at that. And we've gone to buildings that are 5 years old, and they're all falling apart. Because, you know, they're built with wood and vinyl siding, and it just doesn't last. And people want a building, I think, in this town that is going to last 60 years. You know, if they wanted a Morton building and we can't put that in the village, the historic district, sure, you get away a lot cheaper and you'd have a garage. And I don't think the village would go for it because of the aesthetic value you're losing there. And I think we're going to have to answer to the Historical Commission a great deal. They're right on top of this in that area. So I think they're going to dictate to us exactly how that building's going to look.
Well, they may suggest, but then they don't have the final say either. They may suggest, you know, I certainly want it done like that, and I hope the Matusco will come out with that, you know, for maybe a $500,000 extra to add to the cost of making it colonial looking, you know. Do we have anything else? We got to put together some kind of figure for capital for
August 5th.
You think we can put something together for that? August 5th, when is that? Next week?
Next week. A week from tomorrow.
So next Thursday. Can we get together and have a meeting scheduled for next Thursday and come up with a cost?
I can put together a square foot cost based on my history,
mm-hmm.
and give you an architectural cost, what I think an architectural fee will be with a contingency for overruns. And then, the equipment that Mike might want, you'll have to supplement that information.
Could you also do a comparative analysis of a pre-engineered building and see if that is much of a savings or not?
I think you have one here from Belchertown, didn't you? Isn't this Belchertown building, John, a pre-engineered?
Yeah.
And I think that
Granby is, isn't it?
Granby says yes.
Granby.
The one I have in front of me is Belchertown, and that was built in 98. That's 15 years ago.
Yeah.
I can make a couple of inquiries and try and get you some numbers to see if there's a savings with the pre-engineered frame.
See, Sunderland's pre-engineered. I don't even like the way that thing is. It's just like there's too many valleys and everything else in that. And then they got troubles with it.
Whatever you pick out for a design, you know.
Yeah, right.
Is August 5th the hard date with the Capitol Committee?
That's what David Nixon gave me. And August 10th is the select board meeting.
I think August 5th was the date that David was asking that all of the Capitol be submitted by.
Right.
So I don't think the Capitol is actually having a meeting that we have to present something. I think we could probably just ask David if this committee could have an extension on that date.
Do you think all of us could go and get the prices and what on everything is needed here? You're going to take care of everything inside that building, right? Like,
well, I'll hunt out some comparables. You know, obviously things are going to change a little bit, but I'll get you some comparables and we'll come up with a number, a square foot number based on the footprint of the building,
mm-hmm.
and a budget for an architect. And we'd have to ask David if we need to engage an OPM in this, but you're probably going to have a clerk of the works to watch it.
Uh-huh.
If you don't have an OPM, you're going to probably have a clerk of the works. And then the only thing would be any sort of equipment that the departments want to put in the building. You know, a radio tower or radios for dispatching.
How are you going to, find out if that tower that's in Montgomery is going to work?
Yeah.
Or
yes. And well, I'll make
so
sure.
So your construction costs, that doesn't cost the drainage, does it?
It will cover the drainage, cover it all.
The $125,000? That's for that MS4.
Well, I'm talking about...
And the whole site.
I was talking about the numbers that I was offering you in the $300 range. It's going to be all-encompassing. It's going to be site and building. And then on top of that, I will have a separate line item for contingency, which is going to be a percentage. I'm going to tell you it's probably going to be 10% or so.
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll have architectural fee, which will be another 10%. So I'll have line items, and you can say, okay, construction of the building, X, contingency, a percentage, architectural fee, a percentage, and then we have probably have a clerk or an OPM. That part I don't know off the top of my head.
I know that the town has $50,000 for that OPM. Right?
Well, I was going to say, even if you hire somebody part-time, you're going to spend that.
Mm. But the town is supposedly already hiring one. But would he be...
I don't know whether he's assigned per project.
I don't know either. That's, does anybody know the definition of that? Donald?
At this point. Everybody seemed to think that he probably wouldn't be ready for this project. I think they're projecting him to go on the project with the safety complex, right? With the roof and stuff?
I haven't heard. The last I heard was when we had presented to the select board the final.
We haven't even we've selected someone in the process of negotiating a contract, I believe. So,
from a business standpoint, if you're paying somebody $50,000, it's probably for that project you're talking about, which is the roof. Not a lot of money.
I think it was the initial setup just to have them kind of an on-call person. So I think that's what I gathered from when we were interviewing everybody.
Wasn't he supposed to estimate the projects too?
I don't know.
Your architect, when you get down to it, your architect will give you a budget before it goes out to bid. And you review that and you can trim it. Or you can add to it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your architect's going to come in with an estimate before you start.
Everybody thinks this person's going to be a miracle worker. The Council on Aging have come in and they want him to design a whole building. It doesn't work that way.
An OPM is not a designer.
I know.
He's just an administrator.
I know.
Well, all right then. So let's set this target for August 5th, that we're going to work on prices for everything and all the equipment. And also, if we have to, what could you scale back?
Well, I mean, the way I looked at it, and maybe I can get a better handle on the hazmat side of it, but a lot of those spaces are just, it's...
Why don't you leave it the way it is? Let's see where the picture is.
But then,
and then we can start to talk about do we need to scale back. I only brought that up because I think this committee needs to be prepared to answer that question.
I agree.
But I think the committee needs to be able to answer to it when we sit before the taxpayer and say, here's what we're proposing, and we have to stand behind what we're presenting to them. So we should know.
My response is we have that problem with our present public safety complex. There wasn't enough money spent and for the design in that building to meet its needs over those 20 years. So I just hope that we don't make that same mistake again with this project.
The only reason why I was asking about the hazmat, just so I have an idea of what equipment I wouldn't have to estimate.
Then,
so.
It depends on how full-blown you want to get.
Yeah, I mean, I was looking at it as open space to park trucks in.
Well,
obviously,
right.
we need the underground drainage and
the numbers. The numbers I've shared with you tonight are projects we bid. And what drives the number cuckoo is that equipment.
Uh-huh.
Right, so the office space is, the creation of office space is not a high cost, correct?
No.
So I think that's what the majority of that is. The dispatch center, obviously, there's an expense to that, but the emergency generator, that kind of, so the emergency generator, is that, that's not considered the hazmat?
No.
That would be something we'd have to price out.
That'd be in the bill, that would be in the construction cost.
Okay.
But your cost of your exhaust to running those trucks in, you would have to add that.
Yeah, that wouldn't be part of it.
That would not be in.
That's a specialty, so you would have to get a price.
But like the underground work, do you have to have an oil water separator, I'm assuming, for this, for when you're rinsing the trucks off and all?
Yes.
That's included in that price?
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess my question is, the Board of Selectmen already has the warrant reserved for this project, the number four on the warrant. Is it this committee's projection to have something ready for fall town meeting?
We sure hope so.
What, I think you have to do this in phases. I think you have to come up with a plan, come up what you think it's gonna cost, get the town to buy into it, and then engage an architect and refine what you wanna do. And then you're gonna say, this is what we're gonna spend.
So if we can come up, it behooves us to come up with a dollar figure here regardless. It may not be set in concrete, but we have to get in the ballpark somewhere.
Right. At least so the taxpayers know whether they should have this group continue or not.
And the board is proposing a fiscal forum prior to the annual town meeting, the fall town meeting, like 3 weeks before, to inform people of all the financial situations and let all boards talk what they want for the future. And hopefully by then, we'll have the warrant set maybe with all the articles and be able to talk how they could get funded or can't get funded or recommended or not. So this is all contingent on the big picture, as you know, as a finance committee meeting. You have to look at everything. We just can't look at this building. But the one thing that stands out with me, the Municipal Building Committee has tapped this as their number one priority to get done first.
And the select.
So, and you know, the select board has endorsed it too, so.
So you're thinking, Frank, even at the October meeting coming up, there's not enough time to pick out a building, estimate the cost of it, the appearance of what it's gonna look like, and ask the people if they will support that at the October meeting?
I think you're asking a lot in that time frame.
Yeah. So you would wanna go with one phase of this process for the fall and then come back in the spring?
I think, and Howard can jump in and comment here, but I think what you have to do is you have to say, okay, this is what this committee has recommended. We're recommending that we spend, or the taxpayers spend, and I'm just throwing a number out here, don't misunderstand here on community television. If we turn around and say to the taxpayers, we're gonna spend $3 million for a substation, we'd like your approval so that we can then move forward. I think that's what you have to do. You have to make the pitch to the taxpayer to spend that kind of money to.
Yeah, or whatever that amount is.
Right.
If it's $2 million.
Please don't misunderstand.
Right.
$3 million is just arbitrary.
Right.
But at the same time, the library's coming forth with a proposal. The Council on Aging is coming forth with a proposal. We're talking a significant amount of money for infrastructure in this town. So, and the school board is crying for more money also. So it's not gonna be an easy answer.
What I believe are the proper steps is what I'm suggesting.
And I think you're suggesting the way to do it is right. I agree with you 100%.
I'm not sure that we're saying the same thing, but tossing out the X amount of dollars for whatever we have a preliminary estimate of the building costs, I think you'd also want to have town meeting vote Y amount of dollars to proceed, so that, you know, you get that next, whether it's hiring an architect and designing or go through a process, so that you work a preliminary plan, come before the town meeting or informational meetings, so that people can see what we're looking at. But rather than just have them say, okay, we're supporting your $3 million project without being able to get $100,000 or $200,000 to proceed, you know, we're back in the same place we are now.
We're sort of putting the cart before the horse, too. We have to go, because they're both North Hadley Hall and this proposed project are going on two non-conforming lots.
Yep.
So you have to go to the ZBA, get their approval, mm-hmm. and then you have to go to the planning board for their approval.
Right.
And that would eliminate, if it passes in both of them, the hall would be all set. But then we have the third hurdle for the complex. We have to go to town meeting after that.
Right. And election. So, and an election after that.
Yeah.
But again, the fall time meeting is where we would appropriate money for an architect to come with a design, wouldn't it? Where would that money come from?
Well, I would, as Howard has said, you would go before the taxpayer and say, okay, this is the project we want to build, and this is the budget that we are asking the taxpayers to support.
Mm-hmm.
And then once you've got the budget, then you can, once the taxpayers approve it, then you can engage the architect and move forward. And what Howard has shared with you is you make that number, say the building is, the number we were throwing around here was $3 million. And it's only a throw around number. So you go to the taxpayer and you say, we're talking about a project all encompassing, say, 3.5 or 3.25, which is higher than the project. And you get the taxpayers to buy into that, they set aside the money, and then you can start designing and building and doing what you need to do.
But wouldn't that money need that vote, the town meeting vote, wouldn't that take another override vote in an election to appropriate that money?
It may, depending upon how you're going to fund it. That's why I was saying, rather than get a full vote for the 3 or 3.5 million, inform them that that's going to be the total cost. We're not looking for that right now. We're looking for 300,000 or 200,000 to proceed to get us to a point where, say, you get to Springtown meeting. You know, that's the next goal, to have a preliminary set of plans so that they can see what it looks like. And by then you'll go through all the processes that we have to in
that makes sense.
With the ZBA and planning, historical commission,
mm-hmm.
wetlands to make sure that you can
already went in front of the conservation commission, and that's all we have to do with the far as the wetlands is comply with that MS4.
You still have to have, you'll get an order of conditions, right, because you're within that, so there'll be a full-blown submission to conservation.
But they would have to look at an engineered plan for that,
right,
MS4, right, at that point.
I think something else we've got to talk about as a committee, you know, all of these things adding up dollars and cents, and people can't be taking it out of their pocket. We haven't got any seed money for this committee. Other ones get like $5,000 to do a project of this scope. You know, maybe we're not going to spend it or anything, and we'll be very frugal with it, but it's very costly to get all this information. It doesn't come free. You know, and I don't know if we could go to the building committee. They have some extra money for something like this to lot out of that money that they're awarded. You know, some seed money. We've been taking it from some town hall accounts that were left over from last year. You know, the main plan that got done by Randy Isaac, that was $500.
Right.
You know, we picked it up. A lot of other things, you know, we're utilizing town facilities, which is okay, but I don't know how we handle this, you know. I'm open for suggestions on that from anybody here.
Well, our next step is just we gotta put together the finish the plan that what we're gonna ask for, and roughly some money, what it's gonna cost to do it, and present that to capital.
I think that August 5th is a real tight deadline to do that, and I would suggest that we talk to if David's the one that's calling the date.
He's on vacation somewhere.
He's collecting everyone's capital by August 5th. So, like I said, I don't want to speak for him, but I would imagine if you went and talked to him, you know, he.
I don't know if that's the deadline for the capital, or is that what he's asking for?
I don't know. John, if you come to my office.
He wrote here capital due August 5th. Yeah.
I have the memo that he sent out. I can tell you whatever his exact words are. It's at my office. It, to me, the way I read it was just that. That was when he would like everyone to turn their capital into him by. Set up a meeting with me, come sit down with me, it's due by August 5th. That's what he said. So I don't think that is when you have to go before capital, or when the capital committee has to get all this information. That's when we get it to David. David puts it into the spreadsheet, and then he gives it to capital, and then we all have to meet. So I would imagine there's probably some time built in there for, you know.
Well, I mean, can we shoot for the next meeting to try to put this together and see what happens?
I don't think August 5th is a date either, because David, we have a hearing August 1st.
Well, you don't
an
know.
An executive hearing, he's going to be here. And then after that, I understand he's leaving for California for 10 days. So he's not going to plan any kind of big projects to happen while he's away and not be able to be in attendance. So.
Is he in town now?
He was, but I think he's gone for the weekend. He had a meeting somewhere this morning and is heading there.
Is he going to be back Monday?
He will be back Monday.
All right, so that we'll talk to.
Check with him on Monday, but I would urge that we take, you know, 2 or 3 weeks really taking a look at the numbers rather than just pulling something
together. Right.
Throwing it.
Being embarrassed that we forgot something here, or we added this twice. Or.
Well, are we going to shoot for next Thursday to start this process, to work on it? I don't think we can take any more vacations.
I'm taking one.
Well, that's okay. But not everybody.
Maybe our schedule is too aggressive, like these two gentlemen are talking right now, for fall town meeting. I don't know what. I think more discussion has to be made and getting numbers, and then we can make a decision what we're going to do. You know.
Well, when is the selectman's decision on the parcel?
You mean for the sites that were coming in? They're already in and they've been opened, and there are no sites in the north, and there are only two sites in center, and they're the same ones that were put in last time.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no additional sites available.
All right. And then when did they make the decision with this particular site and North Hadley Hall?
Well, I asked them what the 13th is your next selectment meeting?
No. 10/17 and
August 10th.
And I think the select board, I'm not going to go set myself in stone on this, but I think what they requested the last time people spoke to them would like this committee to come into the board, and we'll allot you all the time you want and do a presentation, and then I think the board is going to vote either supporting or not.
Yeah. Right. Nixon said he's going to give us like a half hour on there for a presentation. So if we meet that Thursday, I think we can put things together for a presentation for them.
For the 10th?
Huh?
For the 10th or the 17th?
No, for their 10th. No?
I don't know. I think it's quick.
What do you think?
I think you want to give them a good...
Well, if you want basic numbers, I can give you basic numbers by the 5th. If you want them more refined, you got to give me more time.
And if you don't...
Well, why can't we just give them a basic number?
Because you know they're going to send you back and get more, they're going to want more refined numbers.
The more detail you can give them initially, the better off you are.
I mean, you can ask Donald, but I honestly believe that's what they would do. They would.
I think so too.
Because, you know, Frank's right. We got to.
When is your next meeting?
The 10th and 17th.
Then do we want?
Then we have one the 29th. We have a lot of meetings.
The 17th. Do we want? Is that
17th cool? May give everybody enough time. I think Frank 17th would buy you some more time too.
Yeah.
Which would be better?
Be better than the
speak
10th.
Up, Frank.
Don't be bashful.
More time is better.
He's just smiling over there. He's just, the what the heck are you
well,
guys doing
the,
to me?
What, yeah, so the next
exactly.
one's the 29th?
Pardon me?
I'm sorry, Donald, you said
10th? After that, I believe it's the 29th.
10, no, it's 10, 10th, 17th, 17th, and either the 24th or the 31st.
It's maybe, because we're skipping one there.
If you skip one... In the middle, then it's the 31st.
I'm not sure. I can't remember.
It's 31st on the calendar here.
It's 31st on there?
So it's 10, okay. 17, then there's a week off, and then the last day of August. It's a Wednesday.
So
if we
why
planned
don't,
our
here's
meeting,
a suggestion. Why don't we pull some numbers together for roughly the third week of August? That gives us a week to sit down in advance of the select board meeting.
On the 31st.
Right.
And present
and
on the 31st.
We can put some numbers together. We can make our vegetable soup and then move forward from there.
So we would shoot for the we like doing this on Thursdays. Shoot for the 25th then, right? 25th.
For a committee
meeting. It's the Thursday. It's the you're right. Correct. It's the Thursday before that select board meeting.
That's fine.
If that's what you want to do.
I think.
I won't be here.
Are you going to Germany?
I'll be in Germany. Yes.
Take some pictures of their fire station.
So next week we're not going to have a meeting.
I don't think we have enough information to have a meeting.
Okay. You got to get a price too on that exhaust, right? You got to add that.
I have a base number already, but there's four different kinds. So.
So, on our agenda for the next meeting, we're dealing just with cost factors.
If he's not here. If we're going to do the 24th, then he and I will work on what we're going to present, and I can.
You can forward that information?
Well, yeah, I mean, he and I will get it together, and if you need me to present it at the committee.
You want a motion for meeting that day? Or you don't need
let's have a motion for when we're going to meet next, and what we're going to discuss.
I think the chief said it was the 24th.
Hey, Mike, can you
put that in form of a motion outside, or anybody can.
I'll make a motion that the next subcommittee meeting would be August 24th. That's the Thursday before the last select board meeting of August.
That's the scale.
I'll second that motion.
Xerox it, staples.
Is that you want to remember?
Stick it in my mailbox.
I don't know.
Scale.
Somebody else.
I'll second.
He's advisory.
I'm advisory. Can I even make the motion?
All right, August. Wait a minute. August what?
24th.
Thursday.
June.
All right. Can I have everybody's attention?
Yes.
There's a motion August 24th for our next meeting.
There's a second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, August 24th, 7 o'clock, it'll be here?
Yeah, it's open.
That's open, Richard? Okay.
Is there any further discussion of things you want to add to the agenda for that meeting?
Well, that's the question. You guys want to talk to about anything else?
I think your meeting will be full right there.
Just deal with the finances, huh?
With the floor plan and the... Site plan and the finances, that's so we know what we're quoting on. And
okay. Is anybody going to go from this meeting to the ZBA on August 15th. Just if the ZBA don't allow it, then we're just wasting our time, period. There's no sense going forward. Correct?
Yeah. I mean, if the ZBA shuts you down, please let me know, because I'm going to...
Right. Why
3 weeks are busy.
Right. Why waste any time with this? Right?
So.
Yeah.
Everybody agree to that?
I think you, as chairman, will have to represent this committee at that meeting. Someone has to be there to give them the answers.
August 15th?
August 15th. Right.
You know, the more the merrier, too.
Richard, if they're posted there for August 15th, ZBA over here?
Yes, they are.
So, okay, I'll check with John to make sure everything's on tack with that, you know?
Yep.
And we'll be talking to the selectmen about, you know, about what the note here is possibly postponing that. I mean, we still got to establish that line, and if the ZBA don't approve it, then what are we wasting our time?
Exactly.
Right?
And likewise, if the select board doesn't approve it.
Right. Okay, so...
One other interesting... In the back of your book, we had a problem with the town hall. He said he wanted another 20 more feet, adding to his 50. And so we went to Randy Iser and had him lay out a plan of that lot, and he was requesting 20 parking places. And the way Mr. Iser laid it out, he has 20 without any additional footage.
Not necessarily. The one, the three in the back, that's where it slopes down. So all this deck would be shy of the three. But I really believe what he's doing there with that with those apartments, that he's not going to need all the 20. You know, he's counting two parking lots for one studio apartment.
Unless they have parties all the time.
Huh?
Unless they have parties all the time.
Right.
Now, we talked at one point.
That doesn't work across the street like that, right? There's never a problem there, is there, Donald?
Where?
Across the street?
No, it's very quiet. Very nice neighborhood. But now, when we build, is there going to be a separation line between that property and...
If there's an elevation...
The project we're putting on?
If there's an elevation problem, then he's going to have to put a retaining wall there or something, because he can't spill his water on that property, or we can't spill on his property. So that's up to him. That elevation, if you go over there, walk that and look at it, that elevation is quite high to that building. It slopes right down like this. Whether he cuts that down or build it up, he would probably have to put some kind of retaining wall with it, wouldn't it, Howard?
Thank you.
This year.
I don't know. We'd have to. I'm trying to envision what it is. I'd really have to take a look at exactly what it is. But my guess is if that line goes through where the property dips.
Right.
That
the line goes further in beyond the dip.
Right, but I mean he's into the dip. So yeah, we would have to coordinate both projects to make sure that you have a proper elevation.
You know, it's
when you went through that, you looked at it so that would be level, that whole thing would be brought up, would fill level to the road, didn't you, Larry?
Why the road should be level with the road? You're gonna have to put the drainage in, even in front of the building, so all the water stays on site.
Mm-hmm.
You're not gonna be able to have the building up high and slope toward the road. I don't know what he's been designed for. How he's gonna do the drainage?
What did you figure? You figured 3 feet of fill in there?
Bringing in 3 feet of fill.
Right across the whole thing.
May not need that much.
Right.
You're gonna develop fill when you create that underground detention basin. The rear part of the station obviously doesn't have to be as high.
Mm-hmm.
Be lower.
When we initially started this in its infancy, the major plan in the front of the book, we talked about shared parking with the church and possibly him. Is that still our envision?
With who?
Or no? with the town building there.
No parking was shared with him.
None? I don't know. Well, but the church, we definitely talked possibilities, right?
Because, listen, when we toured other departments, the shared stuff could lead, you have a major problem, they run something, they could fill that whole parking up, and you're going to have trouble. Whether behind that station is just totally restricted, you know, for police and fire personnel, and no one else can park there. But, like, remember up in Great Barrington when they had different events, what happens there? Fills up the whole parking, then you're in trouble.
But it's different. They're situated right in the middle of a business district.
Donald,
you know, too. I realize it opens a can of worms, but I think we have to discuss that.
I think
at some point.
I think that all you have to do is say, if the church has a church bazaar and there's a fire and you've let them use the parking lot and Mike's team can't get in the parking lot, you've defeated the whole purpose of putting a substation up there.
Right, that's true.
So I think right off the get-go, you should say the church has a property line, it's on the north, and whoever owns North Hadley Hall, when the dust settles, they're on one side, and the church is on the other, and that's it.
Right.
Don't mix them up.
Exactly.
So I know you're trying to be accommodating to the abutter.
But it'll get you in trouble.
But I think you're going to find it'll get you in trouble.
Yep. Guaranteed.
That's why I thought it has to be discussed, you know. No one's really said anything about
other
it.
Other departments told us that, yeah. Donald. They talked that.
Well, Mr. Greenbaum is no longer proposing a community room in that building either. All he's proposing now is 10 studio apartments. So
you don't have the room for parking for a meeting room.
I know, but that was a stipulation on the original contract, that he had to put a meeting room in there.
Right.
But that's being negotiated out right now. So,
anything else? All right. So the next meeting, August 24th, 7 o'clock. I'm gonna go to the ZBA on the.
I'll go with you, John.
All right. Good. Thank you, Howard. All right. Is there a motion to?
I make a second
adjourn.
To adjourn.
He motioned. Somebody made a motion. Frank seconded.
I'll make the motion.
All in favor.
You drew.
Howard made motion.
You brought it up first.
Meeting adjourned. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, Richard.